It's nice to see alumni, faculty, and guests here tonight. For most of the students who were in the Capstone Workshop course this semester, these are the final days for them at Columbia. So tonight's event is also something of a graduation party. So thank you to all of our guests for joining us. All right, the next presentation is about sustainability innovation, and Maha Masood Siddiq will give us the presentation. Please welcome her.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Maha Masood Siddiq, and on behalf of my Capstone team, I'll be presenting Innovations in Urban Sustainability. Now, at the US Conference of Mayors this year, city leaders from across the country vowed to build a sustainable economy and a low-carbon future. The push for cities to lead on climate change makes the need for evaluating the success of these sustainable innovations across the country more than ever right now. And it is this need that brought our client, Bloomberg Associates, to us with our project. They're a pro bono consulting company that was founded by the former mayor of New York, Michael Bloomberg, and their mission is to help cities and urban environments around the world in developing enhancing the quality of life of urban citizens. And with that, they came to us with the aim of evaluating existing sustainable environments within the US. Now, Bloomberg Associates came to us to evaluate the current state of sustainability innovations across and within American cities. And by reviewing city sustainability reports, state programs, and federal data, we were able to develop a scoring methodology and a framework that helped us to evaluate these innovations within and across American cities and evaluate the scalability and current maturity. It also helped us to evaluate the barriers and the success associated to their adoption within and across cities. Now, our team researched innovations across a range of city systems, including energy, wastewater treatment, waste management, infrastructure, and water conservation. And then after multiple evaluation and team meetings and feedback from our client, we were able to narrow our innovations down to 10 innovations. As you can see on the screen, the researched innovations include pay-as-you-throw, bike share, community solar, LED lighting, and 6 others, to name a few. Now, before we go into the evaluation of our scoring framework and our criteria, it is important to understand the boundaries associated to our project. Firstly, our client wanted us to, it is important, our analysis is limited to US cities with a population of more than 250,000, which limited our scope to 83 cities. Secondly, this project does not aim to evaluate the sustainability benefits associated to these innovations, such as GHG emission reduction or water conservation. This is purely an evaluation of the state of maturity of these innovations across these 83 cities. Now, our client wanted us to evaluate the state of these innovations within individual cities and how well they were faring nationally across all 83 cities in scope. And in order to do that, we took a deep dive into 8 to 10 cities for each innovation for a within-city analysis, and then took a holistic evaluation throughout all cities for an across-cities evaluation. And to achieve that, we developed quantitative and qualitative criteria. For quantitative criteria within cities, we had the scale of the adoption of an innovation within a city, and the pace of its adoption within a city as well, which refers to the time frame from the day of its adoption to its maturity. And for an across cities evaluation, we once again had the scale of its adoption across all 83 cities, and also the pace of its adoption across these cities. Now, to further evaluate our quantitative scoring criteria, I would like to take in LED and bike share as examples. Now, as you can see on the screen, we developed a rubric of percentages and mapped it to a score of 1 to 5. And as you can see, for scale of adoption, LED street lighting has a penetration of 87% among street lights evaluated for the cities, and hence gets a score of 5. Whereas bike share has only taken up 1% of the transportation sector, and hence gets a score of 1. This exercise was repeated throughout all innovations for all four criteria explained. Now, to give a more holistic evaluation of the barriers to sustainability, we also developed four qualitative criteria. For within cities, we evaluated the regulatory needs required for the adoption of an innovation within a city and the existence of a private marketplace that's there within a city to help ease its adoption. For across cities, we evaluated the ease of replicability of an innovation across multiple cities and also looked into this level of federal and state support an innovation has. To further explain our qualitative criteria and scoring, I'll be taking in pay-as-you-throw and building retrofits as examples. We once again developed a rubric of qualitative measures and developed a scoring once again of 1 to 5 corresponding to it. So as you can see on the screen, for replicability across cities, pay-as-you-throw is intuitive and easy to replicate and hence gets a score of 5. Building retrofits, on the other hand, have city funding limitations and require tailoring and hence get a score of 3. This exercise was once again repeated for all four criteria throughout all innovations, and a total score was allocated to each innovation under question. The total score was divided into within cities and an across city score for all the indicators that have been discussed. Now, once we had done that and once we had developed it, this scoring exercise enabled us to rank these innovations against each other on the basis of their current state of maturity and scalability and the barriers associated to them, and enabled us to graph them. By normalizing these innovations and putting them on a chart, we've separated their impressions of current success and evaluated them on their current state of scalability and maturity within the cities across the US. So as you can see, the x-axis on the graph refers to the state of the scalability of an innovation within the cities, whereas y-axis denotes to the cumulative score that an innovation received for an across-cities analysis. This exercise also enabled us to understand where these innovations stand, and innovations such as LED that have paced well across cities and within cities fare well on our chart. On the other hand, as discussed earlier, innovations such as bike share that have had a very fast rate of adoption across cities, but limited penetration within cities and have regulatory constraints, it doesn't do so well on our within city axis, but does well on the across city axis. Now, we also discussed pay-as-you-throw. Now, despite easy replicability, pay-as-you-throw has limitations, has implementation barriers within large cities, which causes it to be not present in the majority of the cities under scope, which are large cities, and hence it doesn't do so well on our chart. And the same is the case with community solar, that has barriers in the form of regulatory needs and is hard to replicate because of varying virtual net metering policies across states, and hence it also doesn't do well on our chart. Now, this exercise has enabled us to not only evaluate these innovations against each other, but has also helped us to show city managers where the current innovations stand, and they can make an informed decision before implementing an innovation within their city. Now, this exercise not only enabled us to analyze which innovations had scaled and which hadn't, it also helped us to understand a few key trends and barriers. And the first of which is the fast adoption of an innovation does not necessarily guarantee that it's penetrating at a very high rate within cities as well. And we've analyzed that there are 4 innovations, including LED and bike share, that have seen rapid growth across cities over the past 3 years. However, bike share, as we've talked earlier, hasn't had a very high penetration within cities. Secondly, cost does not always inhibit adoption, and we saw that in the case of biogas energy. Now, with federal and state support, along with funding mechanisms, biogas energy has been embraced by cities across the US, and despite a very high upfront cost. And thirdly, whenever the success of an innovation and its adoption lies in the hands of a customer, such as the case of community solar and retrofits, the innovation tends to struggle to scale. Now, these findings, along with our robust framework, were aimed in helping city managers and city leaders across the world in evaluating their decisions regarding implementing sustainability innovations within their cities. This analysis will help our client in evaluating the existing state of scalability and maturity of these sustainability innovations, separate hype from reality, and adequately advise cities in building sustainable, robust environments for the future. I hope you enjoyed the presentation and look forward to your questions. Thank you.
Okay, questions for Maham. One here, Greta.
So these different innovations obviously deal with very different sustainability issues and problems. Was your framework also thinking about and scoring in terms of the kind of impact these different innovations have?
I think, as I like mentioned in our parameters as well, that our framework does not evaluate what sustainability impact an innovation might have. For instance, if installing community solar reduces GHG emissions for a city, we're not taking that into account. We're purely evaluating where an innovation stands in terms of maturity, how many cities have adopted it, what are the barriers, how well an innovation is doing within a city as well. So the criteria was purely for a scalability evaluation, not a sustainability evaluation.
Other questions? Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.